With that, welcome Dan.
Good morning.
Hey. Good morning.
I also acquired another skill I found out at the airport yesterday morning. You know, they say get there early because of the long lines. Well, the only long line I found yesterday was at McDonald's. I waited an hour, but I finally got in there. No, I went through, you don't have to go through the metal detector. Now, I didn't have a belt on purpose, so I wouldn't have to, like, do that. And my shoes were not whatever, and I had nothing in my pockets. I go through the first one, and whoop, whoop, whoop. They said, oh, go through it again. Whoop, whoop, whoop. They said, well, go through the other one. You have to hold up your hands and, like, photograph your genitals. You know that one, don't you? That one off, too. I thought, gosh, you know. And they finally gave up. They said, oh, just come on, you know. But, you know, sometimes when I go into a store, all the computers go down. Just a gift I have, you know. And, of course, the women in the priesthood all have this running thing. They say, what is it with you, Chesbro? You come into town, I get my period. I said, I don't know what that's all about, but I don't know. I'll accept that. Last weekend, I was in upstate New York in a place called Mount Kisco, which is too far from, you know, who lives in Chappaqua. That other person, Hillary and Bill live up there. In fact, the woman who used to sponsor me in doing ordinations at Chappaqua, Helen, was the real estate agent who got them their home out there. And at one point, Hillary's mother wanted to move out there too, but then she changed her mind. I don't know why, you know, but their chauffeur, handyman, I think his name is George, I'm not sure anymore, was in Helen's house and the phone rang and it was Bill. Hillary couldn't find her glasses. And she said, ask George where Hillary's glasses are. I think it was Mother's Day or some crazy thing. Anyway, so I'm in Mount Kisco and they said, well, you know, you're here to do ordinations, but a lot of us are really rather concerned about what's going on, what's happening? Why are things getting so crazy? You know, and I said, well, I have an answer for that. So I thought I would share that with you today. Really simple stuff, you know? So anyway, part of the thing that's going on, as you all know, is the geophysical. You know, we have a living planet who is going through some major shifts and changes within her skin. You know, that her internal part is always turning over and molting, you know. Tom Sawyer, who most of you know about Tom Sawyer, not Mark Twain's buddy, but the other one, said the Earth is capable of turning herself inside out in 24 hours and we would all be expelled. You know, we're in a school. Planet Earth is a school. You're here to learn about love and creativity against a backdrop of greed and ego. Obviously, there's a lot of that. So anyway, when I got in there, I'd just been watching the news or whatever, and they were talking about the St. Andreas Fault and that it's locked and loaded and ready to go. Like any minute, that whole thing could just shake, rattle, and roll, more so than it has done since 1840 or something like that. So we've got that happening. We've got the Ecuadorian earthquakes. We've got volcanoes and all of that. And it reminded me of what Tom Sawyer had said about the New Age. He said, the New Age will begin with a series of earthquakes and volcanoes. And so sure it had. When I was with him in Tibet, in Lhasa, we were in a cave in Chokpori Hill, and there was a crack in the wall in the cave, and Tom was in there with tears coming down his eyes. He said, what's going on? And he said, well, I was with God, of course, when he died, and they had conversation. Oh, by the way, one of the things that God said to Tom, about this free will thing, I think I made a mistake. Too late now, it's out there, you know, it's gone. So anyway, but Tom was crying because of seeing this, and he said, well, God told me that the Holy Mountain would have a crack in it. And we had a Chinese guide, Willie, who was with us, a woman, and she'd come there to go to school in Lhasa. And Tom said, well, how soon was the earthquake? And she quoted a date, whatever. And that earthquake was so strong that it cracked the Holy Mountain. It changed the water table in Tibet. And I had been in another part of the cave with these little monks. I call them little monkettes. They were small. And we were jumping in the mud puddles. Well, they weren't there before the earthquake. The water table had changed. But Tom said, why do I have to be like Doubting Thomas to put my finger in the wounds? And I'm thinking, oh my God. You know, because we're all thinking, well, when does the New Age start? Is there going to be some special event? You know, be PBS special or whatever. And no, it's here. You know, so part of the reason why we're going through the crazies right now, and we are, my God, it's bizarre, is because we are in the New Age, and the New Age is about, as you know, egalitarianism or equality among all sentient beings, not just the two-leggeds. You know, it's everybody's in this thing together. And so the earthquakes, the volcanoes, all those things that are quickening the planet are birthing this new age, which is already a part of the thing. How we can see it socially is the changes that are happening politically. Just 2 or 3 days ago in, was it Hong Kong, China, they elected, I think, their first woman president. You know, and that kind of phenomenon is going globally. So the female or feminine energy is coming to the fore politically, economically, and in so many ways, and that's all part of the balance and the shift. You know, oh, I forgot to tell you, when I got to the airport, no, I got an email from the ticket people, Delta, and they put my name out as Daniela. I said, what? Well, my middle initial is A. They just kind of scooched it over. And I thought, now I'm in trouble, because I'm going to get to the airport before everybody else, because it was like 4 o'clock in the morning, and I'm not Daniela. I don't intend to become Daniela. They don't know that, I do. But I said, okay, well, we're going in there. They'll probably not have my ticket in the thing when you put in your credit card, and it pops Daniel, not Daniela, so I'm in trouble. Well, God gave me a lovely woman who walked up. She said, may I help you? I said, would you please? I said, I'm having an identity crisis. I said, I'm not Daniela, so which bathroom do I use? She laughed. Thank God she had a sense of humor. So everything went through. She said, oh, sometimes a computer does it. It'll take your middle initial and squish it in with your first name, like, you know, Frank A or whatever, you know. So that got all straightened out. And then I had to go through the machine. That was another quandary, you know, and waiting for McDonald's and all that. So, but that's all part of this time. So I'll be 72 this summer. This is the most bizarre political year I've ever lived. You too? It's unbelievable what's happening, you know, all over the place. I'm thinking, all right, let's get some understanding on this. This is the new age. It's about egalitarianism. Everything will have to change. Everything will have to become equalized at some point. And sometimes we're a little rigid here and there, and so we're going through some shifting all over the place, not just this country, but all over the world, to accommodate for equality. I love PBS. You know, I'm a late night person. I wake up at 3 in the morning, turn on the TV, which is usually on anyway, and here's PBS, and I'm watching a show. Did you catch the one called The Walking Lions of India? Anybody? I'm not the only one who saw that show. You've got to catch this. You saw it? Isn't it incredible? Well, at one point in our recent history, the lions in India were pretty much extinct. They killed them all off pretty much. Well, now they're back. But they came back with a sense of consciousness or awareness for the humans. And why they're called the walking lions of India is, here's like a main dirt road, and here comes a pride of lions walking down, and people side by side. And they're not eating the humans, they're not shooting the lions, they figured out how they can work this thing out. Then there was another scene of a bunch of farmers who had a campfire going, it was late in the evening, the pride came up and laid down all around the farmers. Isn't that wild? I thought, this is incredible. Did you see the one where the guy is having a friendship with an alligator or a crocodile? Did you see that one? No? Oh, you gotta see that. What show do you watch? Have I got the only channel that carries this stuff? Yeah. No, there's a guy, and there's a, I don't know the difference between an alligator and a crocodile. Personally, I don't think I want to get too close to them. However, these two are friends. Yeah, the alligator, we'll call him an alligator, he comes up on the beach, puts up his nose, the man reaches down, they touch noses and kind of kiss on the nose, then the man jumps in the water with the crocodile, they wrestle, he tickles the crocodile's belly, they're having a great time, and then they rest. I'm thinking, this is just really great. This is just really great, you know. Or the mother cat who went in and rescued a baby rabbit because the mother died. You probably saw that one. She brought it into her box with her babies and she nursed the rabbit. Now, if the critters can figure this out, what's our problem? You know what I'm saying? So the shake, rattle, and roll, I think, is partly getting us ready to be able to love ourselves and love one another. Because one of the things that Tom always said, too, is when there's an earthquake, A certain percent of that is, of course, geophysical, it's nature. Another part is spiritual. In other words, if you've lived next door to somebody for 10 years and you've never said hi to your neighbor or whatever, which can happen in New England, that's where I'm from, here's an earthquake. All of a sudden, there's nothing, and you're out and you're helping one another. Many years ago, we had a really bad ice storm in Rochester, New York. I think it was in March, early March. And in the morning, it was like 60, 65, 70, and then the temperature dropped like 40 degrees, and it started raining, and then it was snowing, and then everything turned to ice. And the trees were covered with ice about like that around the branches. And as the sun came up, the trees were all breaking and falling down. Well, the whole city was paralyzed with ice. I think we only had one death. And it was ironic because maybe only one house on the block would have electricity when nobody did. I don't know how that happened. Maybe they had a generator, you know. But out of their house, they ran extension cords. Now, I live out in the country, out in the boonies. And we don't even have enough Democrats in our part of the town to have a Democratic Party. That's how small our group is. However, they're all farmers and they're hunters. So they opened the local lodge, and everybody brought in all their frozen deer meat and everything. And we ate for like 3 days. I mean, otherwise it would have spoiled. It was just, you know, kind of a wonderful thing. So we've got this time that Tom Sawyer would also be called the Peaceable Kingdom. The Peaceable Kingdom reminded me of that painting that's hung in the art museum, I think in Philadelphia, I think it's still out there. You've got the lion and the lamb and all the critters that are all happy getting to go. Well, when I see this guy being friends with an alligator or the lions coming down the street in India, I'm thinking, I think we're going to have this as part of the new age. Equality among all sentient beings, not just the two-leggeds. You know, so I'm looking forward to that. I'm really looking forward to that. So this time spiritually is interesting too, because we have so many diverse groups, you know, among us. In the priesthood, what I love about the work that we get to do with each other is we have Christians, Jews, Buddhists, Hindu, Wiccan, Aztec, you name it. Everybody's the same. It's like a round table, a big round table. Everybody's equal. There's no hierarchy. So every group is treated the same. You know, from the very first person ordained was African-American lesbian lady from Queens, New York, who now lives out in Sedona, and she's in her 90s. She's written a couple of novels. She had a boyfriend a couple of years ago who was 51. Talk about cougar. the lion laying down with a lamb, you say. Yeah. Oh, that's what I was trying to remember. Tom said, you know, when Rome destroyed Jerusalem in 70 AD, I mean, they really destroyed Jerusalem. They tore down the temple. Only thing left now was the Wailing Wall, supposedly, and all that. Well, they passed a law that no Jews could come back to Jerusalem ever again. I mean, it was forbidden. Now, why am I telling you this story? You know, when you get old, you forget everything you ever knew. If you ever knew anything, you would forget that too. But, okay, we're going backwards in time. Okay. What were we talking about? Thank you. You got it. She's listening. That's good. That was just a test. No, really, because he said it was impossible for a lion and a lamb to lay down together in Judea because there were none. They salted the land, the Romans. After they destroyed Jerusalem, they salted the land. You couldn't grow anything. You know, so there were no lambs and all the lions disappeared. Well, of course, when the British, after the war, the Jews came back to Jerusalem and all that. And now they've had vineyards and all that. So now there is food enough for a lion and a lamb to be together, for one thing, and to now lay down together like the walking lions of India. So that's a part. Thank you for listening. I'll pay you later. So we've got all these different spiritual groups, and we've got groups that are all praying to God. I mean, you all know this. There's only one God. But we've got all these diverse ideas about who and what God is or how it functions and all the rules and regulations. The other thing I absolutely love about the priesthood is we have no doctrine, no dogma, no dress code, no secret songs or clubs or handshakes or whatever. We have freedom. And the people who come in don't have to be something to be a priest. They just come in because they want to serve as teachers and healers. And that's pretty darn good. You know, I got an email this morning, no, Jim got one, from some gal who's coming in later today, and she said, well, what do I have to do to prepare? It's already been done. Just walk in the door. You know, there's nothing you have to do special. You are special. You know, so We have now probably at least 14 to 15,000 priests all around the world, and we're in every major country. And because they're free, they don't have to account to me or an organization. They can do their work as they see fit. Now, one of the things that I love about us, too, is that we're so darn open. There's a man whose name now is Carol from Canada, who was in the process of transgendering. He was ordained in Buffalo last year. And he said, well, what should I do with my certificate? I said, I'll send you two. You get one for you now, and then you get one for Carol later. You know, so we're doing that. There was a beautiful black woman in New York City. And, you know, I'm not just putting those color labels out there, but it's just to let you know how open everything is and all that kind of thing. Well, I kept looking at her and said, gosh, she's really attractive, but she's a big gal, you know. Well, come to find out that she had been a he, had been through all the reassignment surgery and all that, was now a woman. And her name is Moses, which I find is really lovely because it means drawn out of. And so Moses, her ministry is to other transgendered people. Now, all of us could be compassionate and sympathetic for that. We could choose to have that as an understanding, you know. Her ministry is to those people who are going through the process, you know, which I think is great. And then I thought later, I said, how many religions on this planet would willingly and lovingly accept a transgendered person? None that I know of. I'm sure there's probably something out there that would be willing to do that. But unfortunately, you have to search for it. It's not just an automatic situation. And from my way of thinking, I love you just the way you are. You're perfect, you know? In physics, we know that everything is unified. But what we don't know is that what's unifying everything in physics is unconditional love. When Tom was still on the Earth plane with us and we had a chat one evening, actually, it was an afternoon we met at a Perkins restaurant. We were having lunch together, and they had just discovered something called neutrinos. Neutrinos is an invisible energy force that has a consciousness, and it allowed itself to be trapped or caught in heavy water so they could, you know, dissect it or whatever they do with that kind of thing. But he said, but they don't have a device to detect what neutrinos are made of. He said, they're made of unconditional love. That's God. He said, there isn't anything in the world that you can see or not see that isn't made of God. But with this free will thing, we have that. So we're also made of God, but we can believe that we're not. And it's not true, but it is our truth. And God can't interfere in your idea. But everything else that is out there doesn't have will. It is will becoming. So we have creation and evolution at the same time. And so we've got the opportunity to work with our brothers and sisters, but only with their permission. God itself can't teach or heal without your consent. You can pray to God till the cows come home, and God can't interfere in your idea of who and what you are. Once you say yes to the willingness to participate, not by thy will, but thy will, that doesn't do it either, you know. It's about you loving yourself as God does and then allowing that process to go on. So everything is made of unconditional love. So all of these differences that we have among us are about ideas. They're just ideas. You know, let's put somebody from ISIS and somebody from here and somebody from there on an island and we've all got to get along together. We'd figure out how to take care of one another. I do believe that. I could be wrong. You know, but when it comes to, for example, remember Rome passed a law that said no Jews could live in Jerusalem ever again in history? Well, of course, the Roman Empire's not around anymore, for one thing. Yeah. Saladin was the leader of the movement who took over the last Fourth Crusade, I think it was. He was the leader, the winner of the Fourth Crusade. And before they took Jerusalem, he said, look, no bloodshed, and the Jews are invited to come back. I thought, wow, that's really wonderful. But he said, I want to make sure that the Christian churches are going to be okay. So what I'm going to do is give the keys to all the sacred temples to the Muslim families. So if you go to Jerusalem today, you have to wait for a Muslim family to come and unlock the door so you can go in and pray as a Christian. I think that's pretty funny. But, you know, in the priesthood, my son from India is Muslim. His wife was Hindu. She converted so they could be married, you know. He secretly is in love with my oldest daughter, but don't tell anybody. He said, on your 60th birthday, I'm going to send you a plane ticket. You come and see me. And she's in love with him, too. So, you know, love is eternal. Whatever. So we have this wonderful situation of love around the world, but we're divided by ideas. We all put our pants on or whatever we're putting on, our kilts or our skirts or whatever. Oh, this was so funny. I stopped at a rest area in Virginia a couple years ago. I had to pee. Well, you got to go. And I could go into the men's side, so I figured, well, you know, we won't go there. So anyway, I walk in, and here's a Buddhist monk. And whoever thinks, well, how do they do what they do? They hike up their skirts and go. Makes perfect sense to me. I started laughing after that. I said, well, of course. You know, why wouldn't they? You know, whatever. So. You should have to live in here. No, you shouldn't have to live in here. I'm having such a wonderful life. I'm at the point now in my life with God, or the boss I call God, that when I think about something, I immediately have an opportunity to have the experience. I mean, you could have that too if you didn't block it. Honest to God. For example, I was mowing the lawn the other day, and I knew I had to go to the airport at 3 o'clock in the morning, but I knew I wanted a parking space right inside the gate. So I said, boss, I need a parking space, and I want it right inside the gate so when I get there I can park and not worry about parking and go to the thing. So I know now that that is going to be there. I mean, you do this yourself. I'm sure you do. So it was 3:30 in the morning, and I'm pulling into the airport, and I'm looking. The parking lot is full. You know, but I got through the gate. Now they have this automated woman who says, take out the ticket. The gate will open. You know, I'm thinking, oh, geez. So I got in, and I'm looking, and here's my parking space. Pulled right in, parked the car. I said, thank you, boss. You know, went inside. Here's the woman to help me with the ticket, because since I had this concussion, I've had a little trouble sometimes doing logic, you know, so figure that one out. And it kind of goes on from there. So you're always being taken care of. I was on the plane coming here from Detroit with an airline pilot, and I looked at him and thought, gosh, he's awfully young. He looked like he's about 25. Really, honestly. And I said, well, how long have you been flying? He said, oh, I've been flying for 20 years. I said, no way. I said, you don't look old enough to fly a plane. We had a lovely conversation. I really think that he thinks that I'm really crazy. I said, well, I fly too, but I don't often use a plane. I told him about some of my out-of-body experiences. He was probably sitting there going, oh, God, you know, what do I got here? Well, we ended up becoming friends because he's also a single guy, and he's got cats, and I've got cats. So we had common ground here, you know. And he was on his way home. He had one day to get home, sleep in his own bed, and I know what that's like, and see his cats, and then he had to come back and fly an airplane. He'd just come in from Las Vegas, you know. But I sat there in my little inner things talking. He says, you know, you really need to talk to this guy. There's things that he doesn't think about that he needs to maybe think about now, you know. So what happened was there was a new stewardess on the plane. You know how they push that cart down and they offer you food and liquor and whatever they've got, you know. Well, I don't know why she didn't turn to our side of the aisle and offer us anything, but she kept right on going. I thought, it doesn't matter, for God's sake. Well, he was not thrilled about the fact that she'd not offered me a drink. So after a while, he tagged one of the other stewardesses, and he said something, and I thought, oh, he just told her that I wasn't offered a beverage. You know, I thought, well, that's kind of fun. Well, that was my entree into getting to talk to him. You know, so when the gal came, she said, oh, I'm so sorry. And she said, well, what can I get for you? I said, just water. She said, oh, fine. So she brought me the water, and I tagged him. I said, hey, thanks a lot for that, you know. And he said, well, she's new. I said, I think it was your uniform. She's intimidated by your uniform. He said, it'll do that. But that was how we got to talk. And then we talked a little bit. I mentioned Tom Sawyer to him, and that it wasn't Mark Twain's friend, and da-da-da-da-da-da. So it was an interesting hour, which lasted like 20 minutes, you know, of conversation about spirituality. So we've got geophysical things happening. Shake, rattle, and roll to get you out of the house to start talking to your neighbor, the flight attendant or whatever. We've got spiritual evolution. You're all waking up and growing. You know, those of you who've already been ordained, you're on your way to Buddhahood. Did you know that? The energy went to the base of your spine, quickened with the kundalini, and now it's working up through your chakras toward your enlightenment. The goal is to get here and have a 1,000-petal lotus. and have enlightenment. And then that means then that you choose to come back to serve your sisters and brothers to get them through these times of change, which is what this is all about. I was on my tractor. I always talk to God when I'm on my tractor. You know, well, who wouldn't? You know, what else are you going to do? So I'm on my tractor, and I'm talking to the boss. I said, I've decided something. I know I'm coming back. I get recycled every now and then. I said, I'm coming back. But this time when I come back, I want to come back as a full-blown adult. I don't want to do the baby thing next time. I don't want to do the teenage and the zits and the junior prom. No, I'm not doing that. I'm going to be a full-blown adult. You'll probably, at the 6 o'clock news, you'll see this naked man walking around in a Walmart parking lot. That's me. Bring me some clothes and some food, because I'll probably be hungry, you know, and put me to work, because it's been done before. Apparently, when bees are born, they're born as adults. Did you know that? I was watching PBS or something the other day. I've got a great channel. You've got to come to my house and watch my TV. And there were these actors that they had bee suits on, and the female bee was like pushing out another drone or whatever they do, and it's an adult. And they said, yeah, well, when bees birth, they birth adults. I thought, oh, so it's been done before. We can do this again. Of course, when Melchizedek came here the first time, Melchizedek, incidentally, the pronunciation was pretty good, Tina. Where are you, dear? Oh, there you are. In Hebrew, it's Melchizedek. Now, that's a mouthful. Yeah, I know. Melchizedek was never born a woman and never died. It says so right in the Bible. Well, so what? You say, well, what's that truth? Well, when Tom Sawyer died, he had access to total truth. And what he said to me was everything that Edgar Cayce had talked about the Old Testament was 100% true. I said, Tom, that's outrageous. He said, no. When I died, it was exactly the same. So when you're looking at information about Old Testament and all these kinds of things, about Melchizedek, never born a woman and never died. But when God wanted to come into the earth plane at that point in our evolution, just came in as a full-blown adult. The kicker was not physical as we are. Right. I intend to come back, but physical, you know, not a spirit being. But Melchizedek came back as a spirit being. In other words, dense enough in matter to be down to earth. Because a definition of an avatar is a spiritual being that is taking on a lot of mass or energy in order to be down to earth. And not only to be down to earth, but to be available in plain speaking so that you can understand what they've come to teach. All right? So Melchizedek was never born a woman, never died. I thought, well, the bees are doing it. God did it then. You know, it was interesting because after Melchizedek, and also Melchizedek never had a birth, but also never tasted death. One night, Tom Sawyer was talking to us about how many times when God came into the earth plane that it basically, when it left through spontaneous combustion. Like one of the times with Jesus in the cave when he was wrapped in his uncle's linen and his body, poof, you know, it was like a supernova. And what was left on the linen was gamma ash residue, which now the Italian physicists are saying is not anything that anybody can paint on or whatever. So we know that the Shroud of Turin is real. We don't know how it was made, but we really believe that that was the authentic relic. And Tom would have said, yes, and isn't it interesting that all these scientists are holding on to this linen that was wrapped around the body of God and thinking about it? He said, that's pretty cool. So we have information from Edgar Cayce. Some of you cut your teeth on Edgar Cayce. I know I did when I was in my teenage years, who has access to total knowledge. There's a book called Edgar Cayce's Story of the Bible. Have you seen it, some of you? Yeah? That used to be three volumes of material by Robert Krajenki. Man Crowned King, da-da-da-da-da-da. During the last financial debacle in 2008, you know, the ARE was also in trouble, so they stopped printing those volumes. I'm thinking, oh no, because that's the foundation of my school in upstate New York in the summer. You've got to read those three volumes to come to school. Well, they weren't printing them anymore. And if you wanted one, you could spend like $1,000 to somebody out in New Zealand for their copy. I thought, that's ridiculous. I was about ready to change my format, and then somebody came into my house that day and put this big fat book on my coffee table and said, Dan, look. I said, what is it? He said, it's all three volumes of Robert's work in one book. $16, Amazon.com. You can get it now probably for $2 used. You know what I'm saying? But what I'm telling you is, That material is exactly what Tom Sawyer saw when he died, and it's exactly what Edgar Cayce brought through when he was in deep trance. So 100% real. So if you went to school like I did in summer school, and I went to 3 seminaries and all that, and we had all these debates about what's real and what not, you can pick up this one book, and you want to know how God created everything? Read the book. Believe it or not, but your higher power knows it's true also. So you're getting this education, you know. So this is available to everybody. The thing that unites the Christians and the priesthood and Judaism and the Muslims is Melchizedek. Because what the Bible talks about is that Melchizedek took Abraham under his wing and he taught them the Law of One and Sarah. And the Muslims venerate Abraham as a great prophet. But they don't talk about Melchizedek in this connection. But we have that all as a connection. So we have, you know, the common bond of Melchizedek between the Jews, become Christians, Muslims, you know, all of that kind of thing. So here we are back in the island with, it's like the old joke, the Catholic priest, the Protestant, the rabbi. How are they going to survive? If the thing that separates is only ideas, change your attitude. Change your mind. Tom Sawyer said once, if you shift your attitude, you can change a galaxy. What he was referring to, here's a galaxy. Here's all my thought forms about who and what I am and why I'm here and all that kind of stuff. But I may have an attitude about that, and it may not be serving me or others well. So if I change my attitude, I can shift a galaxy. A lot of us were born, well, you were all born, let's face it. You were inside your mother and you were feeling things, and some of you were hearing things, and you were starting to identify yourself by that. And then you're born and you have attitudes about things, and you were told this, you were told that. My mother, God love this woman, she was taking care of her mother who was dying of walking pneumonia. And before grandma died, she said to my mother, well, she's pregnant, I'm just, you know. She said, furthermore, I tried to abort you. I know. I threw myself down the stairs. I guess she saw Gone with the Wind. I don't know. I threw myself down the stairs, but it didn't work. And I tried other things. Nothing worked. Well, personally, I'm glad that that didn't happen. Then she told her that her brother was her father, and then she died. Right. Well, she had a love affair with a young man before the First World War, and she got pregnant. And he went off to the First World War. So his father was a widower. He married my grandmother. It was the honorable thing to do, you know. Well, then he comes home from the war, and now here's this daughter from their union, you know, and that's how that happened. So my mother said, I often wondered why my brother was so fond of me. So anyway, family history, I should write a book. PBS, once again, here we go. The Human Family Tree, you saw that. About we all come from South Africa? You saw that one. You've got a lot of work to do. I should write you out a homework chart tonight. There's a video called The Human Family Tree, and it basically talks about the fact that everybody in the human condition comes from South Africa. That was the first one I saw. In other words, those two folks got together. It was after some cataclysm, which we've had several. They survived it, and their progeny then moved north. And as they did, of course, their melanin changed, so their skin color changed. Everyone used to have brown eyes in those days. Well, as you went farther north, they become blue, you know, and all that. And then that group went to the Middle East, and then they split, and they went into Europe, where there were Neanderthals at the time. And the rest of the human family tree went into China or Mongolia, and then they crossed the land bridge because the oceans were 350 feet shallower in those days. You could literally walk from China to South America. And so they did, right? Now, I just thought that was great because that means that we're all brothers and sisters. Well, there's more. Now, the next video was the family, people of origin or something like that. It's got a title, something about origin of family. Now this one went further, and they said that when that group went into Europe and they found the Neanderthals, they didn't say they had sex with them. I mean, that would be too blunt. They had phrases like, well, they mingled. What do you mean they mingled? How many many dates before you get to mingle? I don't know. Well, they mingled. Do you know, probably everybody in this room has in your DNA Neanderthal? Did you know that?
We do now, because I told you.
However, at the same time, there were at least two other sets of human-type beings in the area of Asia. And when that group went there, they also mingled. And so we have within us this mixture of all this humanness, which I just think is fantastic.
Yeah.
We're all brothers and sisters. We're all part Neanderthal. We're all part those other things, you know. And what is the problem? You know, so what if somebody wants to choose to become a woman or a man or a religion or whatever? It shouldn't really matter at all. Just say, oh, that's right. Have a good time. I'll see you later. Come over for dinner, you know. We're all brothers and sisters. And all of the human condition is on one planet that is playing shake, rattle, and roll to get us to get out of our houses and take care of one another. The first time that really happened in our lifetime was Haiti. Remember Haiti, the earthquake? Haiti is one of the poorest countries on the planet. And we helped to keep it that way with our governments and whatever. Well, the world quickened to Haiti, and unfortunately the nonsense that went on there has kept them still poor after all of that. But what was incredible about that was that the human condition realized that that's part of our family. We need to look out for these people. Now, that kind of thing is what's coming for California and coming for other parts of the country and other parts of the world. So as we're in the new age now, we have an opportunity to also get rid of this idea that we're separate from one another, simply by looking at DNA, if nothing else, you know, in realizing that different religions are just different thoughts, you know, and we're all sitting here a collection of thoughts. You change your attitude about yourself, you change your reality. Now, I teach pretty much every weekend around the United States right now. I've not gone out of this country in a while. But every time I have an opportunity to meet with a group of people, I encourage them to think about the fact that, you know, if you're becoming a priest, you're here to teach and or heal with their permission. And practically everybody in the room, when I say, how many of you are good at giving but not so good on the receiving end, all the hands go up. I say, I'm also a cosmic cop. And I'm here to tell you that you're breaking the law, because if you're only giving and not receiving, you're only doing half your job. Well, you came here to help. You came here to serve, not be served. I got that. However, it doesn't work. If I need something and you're here to serve, you say, well, I took pity on you, so I'm giving you chicken soup for $5 or whatever. You didn't ask my permission. I'm allowing you to do it. God itself doesn't have permission to give me chicken soup without my permission. So who are you? All right, so simply ask, may I offer you my Reiki? May I share with you what I learned today? You get wonderful responses, yes, my God, where have you been? When two more are gathered together, it happens. Or no, they worked hard to get that way, and that's none of your business. All right? So being able to receive is also part of what we're doing in the human condition. Now, we're in school, and one of my friends, Gene, who was one of my first helpers in my life, in this lifetime, Jean Eddy. She came to me in Webster, New York. She was a large woman. And she said, well, all right, so you're good looking, but you gotta have better than looks to get your job done. Whatever that's about. So I said, well, what are we talking? She said, well, you're doing readings. How much are you charging? I said, oh, it's a donation. She said, you can't pay the rent on that. You know, we've got to have a fee scale. So she started to be going in the right direction with different, she did a trifold, and you know, we got, that's how I got to meet you, actually. You know? So years passed, 30 years go by. I get an email from Jean, and she said, I can't find my ordination certificate. Can I have a new one? I thought, well, of course you can. She was one of the first four people that got ordained. She was the second ordination group that happened, I think, second or fourth, somewhere in there. Anyway, it doesn't matter. I said, sure, I'll get one out to you. Well, a few days later, her daughter called from a hospital. She said, well, Mom's in the hospital. And can you come and see her? I thought, you know, I just had an email from her the other day. Sure, I'll come. You know, she's one of my old friends. I hadn't seen her in a long time. Well, I went into the room, and I could tell there was an odor. So there may have been cancer or something with her. I don't know what. But she's in bed, and I walked in, and one of the things that Tom taught us to do when you visit hospitals is something called love bombing, B-A-L-M, not the other kind. And you walk in and you tell them jokes. You know, the bluer the better, whatever gets them laughing. You can't be sick and happy at the same time. The body has to choose. So while they're laughing, they're going to be feeling pretty good, right? So I walked in and there's Jean laying in bed. She's all, you know, hooked up and wired and ready to go. And so I got her laughing. Her daughter said, "Wow, I haven't seen Mom smile in a month." And then she had to leave the room. And while she was out of the room, Jean said to me, "How do you get out of here?" Not how do you get out of the hospital, how do you get out of here? I said, "Oh, Jean, for God's sakes, it's really simple. The lamas do it all the time. You pick a date, like Wednesday, whatever, you know. You go into deep meditation, and on Wednesday, you step out." I said, "But do me a favor. When you leave, I want you to stop by my office and say toodaloo, goodbye." You know. So about 4 days later, I heard that she had, you know, graduated, as we call it. Well, it's a school. You got to graduate. And I'm in my office, and I'm typing, and I have a closet in my office that doesn't, it's got a cloth in front of it. I hear this crash, bang, so, oh, she made a wrong turn. However, when she was still in her bed and I was with her, I said, "Well, honey, it's really easy, but apparently you're not done yet because you're still here." She said, "What are you talking about?" I said, "You come here to teach and heal. So you're not done yet." She goes, "Oh." I said, "Well, it could be a night nurse that you have to smile at. Who knows what it is, but when your work is done, that's when you graduate. So if you're looking at somebody's life and they're like a couple seconds old and their newborn graduated, that's what happened. That baby came here to be a gift toward whomever, and they did their work, they're out of here. Or they live to be 106 years old, like some of us are doing these days, you know, but when you've graduated, your work is done. So you came to teach people how to run the 50-yard dash when you're 106 years old. I watched that on video today. You know, whatever it is, obviously, we're all flunkies because we're still here, right? You wake up tomorrow, you pinch yourself, "Oh, I'm still here, I have another day to make a difference." Somebody said to me recently in class, "Well, I'm just one person, what difference can that make?" I said, "Excuse me? One Mahatma Gandhi, one anybody who's made social change because they refuse to sit at the back of the bus or whatever, it takes one. You're one, but you're significant. And I love you just the way you are." Yeah. So we have geological changes going on. We've got sociological changes going on. We have spiritual changes hopefully going on that will bring us together. And all kinds of ways that we can find ways to figure out how to make this a peaceable kingdom. If you haven't seen the Walking Linda, Lions of India, you can get that on PBS. I get their magazine, so I get all the, what's the latest videos? And they just sent me that one. I'm going to order that. It's great, you know. But there's so much available out there to open the mind, you know, and the heart as well, which is really a good thing. So I'm supposed to shut up at what time? Now? Oh, I still have a couple minutes. Oh, cool. All right. I'm going to do something here I've never done before. Does anyone have any questions, thoughts, or feelings about anything? Just raise your hand. Yes, sir.
What do the lions eat?
Obviously not people. Well, probably. You know, thank you for saying that. Do you know they had to train lions to eat humans in the Colosseum? Because we don't taste good, apparently. We taste pretty bad. So they had to teach lions how to catch and eat and, you know, devour. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe they're becoming vegetarians. I had a friend recently who was lauding the joys of her vegetarianness, you know, and I said, "Well, that's fine. I'm a carnivore. I'm an old blood typer, and I have to have a little red meat every now and then." However, you know, they do know now that when you pull a carrot out of the ground, it complains a little. So everybody's got to eat something to be here. Yeah, so I don't know what they're eating, but obviously not Indians. The DVD said something about they found a way to make peace with each other. Because the lions were almost extinct. They said, "We better shape up or..." Now, I told Jim this yesterday. I don't know how true this is. Maybe you saw this on the news. about there are no more black rhinos on the planet. Did you see that? Some guy with a gun. I don't know if he knew that that was the last one. It didn't matter as far as I'm concerned, you know. And now they're cutting off the horns of the rhinos and putting some salve over them so they won't be killed for their horns. Because in Vietnam or whatever, they think the powder of a rhino is an aphrodisiac. Charles Pfizer should be there with the blue pill. Makes enough money as it is, you know. Yeah. And yet, with love and compassion, would you willingly do that? You know, when you pass over and have a life review, you become everybody that you were ever with. And you go through whatever their choices were as far as your relationship and all that kind of thing. So I don't know how this works with the animals and all that. But, you know, would you do that if you knew that this was how it was going to feel? You know, I don't know. There was, yes, sir.
What was the name of that book you said was on Amazon?
Yes, Edgar Casey's Story of the Bible is the big one. And that's available because Robert Krajewski's three volumes are hard to find. Personally, what is your name?
John.
Personally, John, I would rather still read the three volumes. They seem to be a little more succinct. There's a lot more information in those because I'm still going through the big one. But I was delighted that they made that available. Yeah. Robert Krajewski, K-R-A-J-E-N-K-E. He's also a priest, by the way. He was ordained many years ago. They did a great job of putting these three together, but they kind of synthesized the story. I mean, it's all there. But if you want the details, and I'm a detail person myself, I would get the three volumes. I've got them at home, and boy, they've been read, yeah. But when I realized that it was 100% accurate, oh, I want to add to that also. Thank you for asking that question. So that'll take you up to the birth of Jesus, who is one of the later incarnations of Melchizedek. All right. So if you want to know about Jesus and the Essenes, then you get another little book by Ann Reed, R-E-A-D, called Jesus and His Church. And you get that on Amazon as well for like $2. Okay, it's a little paperback. Because what she says in there is what Edgar Casey talked about as far as Jesus and his connection to the Essenes, to Judith, who was the head of the order when he was born, that his grandmother was an Essene, Mary's mother, Anne, and the arrangement of the marriage and all that. I mean, it goes on and on. It goes right up to the crucifixion. And then the beginning of the Christian churches is just when we got in trouble. They kicked the women out for one thing and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But no, it's a very good and well-written, easily understood, and she does a good job of that. So you want to get Edgar Casey's Story of the Bible and Ann Reed's book, Jesus and His Church, and you'll have the Judeo-Christian story from the beginning of creation, because that's where this other book starts, right up to the resurrection and then the movement of the first Christian churches. Okay? Good, John, you'll enjoy it. Oh, one of them was Man Crown King. They changed the titles over the years, but you can probably go through the ARE to find out what the original titles were, or you can send me an email at chesbrod@aol.com, because I've got them home and I'll give them to you. 1,000 Years to the Promised Land is another one. Yeah? Yeah. But they're exciting because it starts from before creation, you know, when God's imagining and creating everything. Is that my phone? That's your phone. Remember in the old days? Well, you don't remember the old days, but it says, ladies, please remove your hats during the silent films. Now it's please turn off your cell phones. You know. Now, where was it before I went there?
Casey also did a book on the life and story of Jesus.
Yes. I'm sure.
And yep. That our consciousness is mutual. The animals are dependent.
They're all made of God, yeah.
And vice versa, and they will reflect
yeah.
Anyway, that's just what I wanted.
Well, you know, I live out in the country, and I don't hunt. My dad did, but I don't. But, you know, the deer come right up to my house because they know I'm not going to open the door and shoot them, for one thing, you know. But I'm sure that's probably what it is. I mean, they're not dumb animals, as we used to say. You know, they're very, very astute with what's happening. Is there a question over here? There was one over here. No?
Yeah.
Oh, neutrinos, like a neutron, neutrinos. In fact, you had them for breakfast this morning. Yeah, they're invisible, by the way. However, they're everywhere. And there isn't anything in creation that isn't comprised of neutrinos. Okay, since you asked that question, see how this works? It allows my brain to open up. One night we were sitting at Tom's having dinner, and his wife said, Tom, what time is it? He threw his head back and he laughed and he said, well, if you asked Jesus Christ that, he would have said, this is the fourth time the time is coming to an end. Nobody heard him. I did. And years later I said, excuse me, did you say? He said, yes, it takes billions of years from the Big Bang for the universe to expand, but millions to contract, the big crunch. We're on the verge of the big crunch. Now, nothing's going to happen to you and you're not going to get whiplash from the big crunch, you know. But everything that's been imagined by God, first there was something called, we call it the void. Well, the void, the blackness, is the fullness of love before it created light. So God separated itself in the creation of light, and then light went on to create everything, you know, that went beyond that. So in the Big Bang, and then the Big Crunch, the whole universe as we know it is a carbon-based unit. It's all going to collapse in on itself and go back to a single point. Can you imagine the energy and the power of that point? Wow. And then it's going to go kaboom, and here comes another creation. Now, if you recall Edgar Cayce, and when you read this book, you will, we as souls were imagined before the universe. We're actually older than the place we hang out in. We're older than the school that we come to. All right? And we're forever beings. You'll never die. You just won't stay in the spacesuit forever. Okay, but we'll also be part of the next creation of a universe, or universes, if you want to think of it that way. And what Tom said was there's a whole other dimension about experiential life in the next dimension that we just can't have now, but we will have then. You know, he also talked about a time, I think in our lifetime, when we will have anti-gravity cars. We'll no longer be using fossil fuel engines and all that. Tell that to the oil company. They'll probably try to buy gravity, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Yeah, we already had that too. Who is Tom Sawyer?
You sure may, yeah. Tom Sawyer, I used to have a talk show, a TV talk show in Rochester, New York, and one day my business manager called. It was Jean Eddy, the one I told you about earlier. She said, would you like to know who's going to be on the show this week? I said, yeah, who do we have? She said, we have Tom Sawyer. And I laughed, just like most people do when they hear the name. And she said, no, it's not Mark Twain's friend. This is a real guy in Rochester, New York. He had she called it a near-death experience. I learned later it was way beyond that. So early February, I got in my car to go to Rochester to the TV studio to meet Tom Sawyer. You know? And I was sort of impressed with being an ego talk show person and all that malarkey, you know. So it had snowed. We had snow in those days. And I popped my fan belt trying to get out of my driveway because I got stuck in the driveway. And then drove all the way to Rochester without a fan belt. It can be done, I'm told, in cold, cold weather. So we got to the studio, and there's this guy. He was sort of a blue-collar worker guy. I mean, nobody, he was like, oh my God, this guy's handsome. Just a normal person, you know. I had no idea. Now, I'd had a series of death experiences myself, or near death, and, you know, but while he was talking, I'm visualizing, and he's knowing that. So he had one of the most profound, it was May 23rd, which is tomorrow. Hey, thank you for asking the question. May 23rd, 1978, he was under a pickup truck full of firewood. Now, if any of you are country people, you know how heavy that's going to be. And he was teaching his two young boys the proper way to change a transmission leak. So he's under the truck on one of those things, and he had it on 4x4s and jack stands. All of a sudden, the truck went boom, boom, and he was squashed to death. He was dead 15 minutes our time. Well, there is no time anyway. There's only God. But he went into the void. He saw blackness. Then he saw a point of light. He said, the most beautiful light he'd ever seen. That became like a tunnel or a cyclone. And that's when he realized there's only God. There's no evil, there's no sin, there's no devil. Thank God the Pope knows that, and he's telling people. You know, so then he went down the tunnel, he met God, and then God said, he reminded him, he says, we have a contract. You agreed to be born and die and come back from the dead because they're on the verge of thermonuclear war in 1988 on the Middle East if things continue the way, and I can't interfere. So we need you to prevent nuclear war. We need you to teach people that death doesn't exist by surviving it and promote the priesthood because it's become bastardized by thoughts and politics. And he did all those. You know, so then he became one with God, merged with God, came back, was under the truck, was revived, taken to the hospital. The x-ray technician said, I want to see Mr. Sawyer. Now here's a guy squashed to death under a truck. A baby couldn't survive this. No internal injuries. He lived for another 40 years, prevented nuclear war many times. None of us would be in this room today if it were not for that man. He sank three ICBMs by loving an electron. Love is very powerful, right? And a lot of other things, with other countries as well. And when his work was done, he what? Graduated. Now he was born in the ninth day of the ninth year, the ninth second to infinity, when he came in, right? A Virgo to the nines. When he died, he walked into the hospital unit, hospice, carrying his own oxygen. Now, how sick can one be, you know? And they said, he said, well, I'm going to be leaving after midnight. Well, they thought he was kind of, you know. I said, put him over there. They put him in room number 9. Shortly after midnight, he took off. So that's Tom. Yeah. There are books out about him. In fact, send me an email. Chesbrod@AOL.com, and I'll give you the name of the guy who has those books, and you can get them and get to know him a little more. Yeah. My third book, well, Jim and I are working on the third book now. It's about 164 true stories about Tom Sawyer. One of them was the first day that I met him. It had snowed, February, and we were going to Robert Foley's for lunch. On the corner was a bus stuck in a snowbank. Now, we can relate because you're Minnesotans and you know what snow is in buses, right? Well, when was the last time any of you saw a person get out of their car and push a bus out of a snowbank? First time I met him, that was the day he told me how all the dinosaurs died. 36 hours, God caused a vapor to go around the world, and everything was either frozen or fried in 36 hours. The asteroid hit the planet, caused all the intense explosion that blocked the sun, it caused the temperature to drop. Everything that could borrow survived. All the little chickadees that we have, they're remnants of that last cataclysm. And so are we, you know. So I learned all that in one day from him, and a lot more in 40 years, yeah. Now my time is up. Oh, I want to have some fun with you. The last thing I do before I go. Would you mind standing up for just a second? This won't hurt. Okay, let's pretend we're at one of your favorite sports. Whether it be football or basketball or baseball, and your team just got the home run that won the game, the whatever they do out there. And so everybody stands up and the wave goes, yeah! You shifted your attitude. Good for you. You may sit down.
Thank you, Dan Chesbrough.